And welcome to this year's edition of the Sharada Dwivedi Commemorative Lecture. Many of you, I see you all here, were friends and colleagues of Sharada's. And I'm just going to open briefly by recalling her contributions, especially as we are in the Arts Quarter, which she effectively conceived, imagined, and invented together with Rahul Mehrotra. Sharada was passionately in love with her city, which she insisted on calling Bombay, despite the fact that, and this was not all that well known, she was born Sharada Joshi, so she began as someone who had Marathi and English among her several languages, but it was always Bombay to her, because that represented for her a cosmopolitan, inclusive notion of what it means to be a city. And she was, as you all know, the committed opponent of anything in the nature of sectarian thinking or nativist politics. Sharada was a writer, a publisher, a heritage activist, and to many of us, a friend. And as I said, it was really through her discussions and her collaborations with the architect and urban theorist Rahul Mehrotra that this notion of the old part of Bombay as a set of interlocking precincts came into being. It's not like Kalagoda was always an arts precinct. I'm always amused when I see people refer to it now as the Arts Quarter, as if there was a divinely ordained given. It actually came out of certain acts of intellectual labor, and Sharada and Rahul were very, very prominent in that process. It was also through her collaboration with many other colleagues that the Kalagoda Association came into being. She played a prominent role in the association and the festival. And it was actually a shock to many of us when she, without any warning at all, and at a completely unexpected kind of age, just left us. And that happened, as some of you will recall, in the middle of a Kalagoda edition. So at that point, Kevan Mehta and I, who were co-curating the literature section then, thought we would institute this lecture, a commemorative lecture in her honor, to invite people who've addressed many of the themes that she addressed and that were dear to her. So this year it's really a matter of special pride and pleasure and privilege that we have Annapurna Garimella, because Annapurna's work maps in many ways with onto Sharada's work as a publisher, someone concerned with art writing. So I'm going to introduce Annapurna in this context. Annapurna now lives in Delhi. She's an art historian and a designer. And her research has focused on late medieval Indic architecture and the history and practices of what she calls vernacular in the contemporary, which is a very nuanced, textured, and thoughtful way of addressing forms that have often been called the crafts or the traditional arts. And through her work, she really invites us to engage with what this might mean. What do we really mean when we speak of tradition and modernity? Are they, in fact, two separate things? Are they interwoven? What are the vexations that attend their relationship? Annapurna is also the founding and managing trustee of ART, Art Resources and Teaching Trust, which is a not-for-profit organization that runs a public art library, which resonates well with our context here, which conducts independent research projects, and also is deeply engaged in pedagogy. Among her recent curatorial projects are Vernacular in the Contemporary, which she curated at the Devi Art Foundation in Delhi, and also Faith, Manu Parekh in Banaras 1980 to 2012, which was a very specific survey of a major, if unremarked, artist, contemporary artist, that was for Gallery Espace in Delhi. Annapurna has also been research editor of the Marg Foundation, yet another connection with the neighborhood, Marg looks down upon us from the north. She's also been Getty Distinguished Visiting Professor at the JNU and lecturer for the American Institute of Archaeology Travel Program in South Asia. The figures who've played a prominent role in her imagination and her academic work are Mulkraj Anand, seminal figure for Indian art and for Indian cultural life, Akbar Padamsi, the painter and thinker, and the miniature artist Rakesh Vijay, who we know through his collaboration and his work with the American photographer X. Wazwo. And Annapurna is going to address today a subject that has a very, I would say, tense history, and which is why I'm really looking forward to this talk. It's called Amidst the Art Public, Writing as Analysis, Exhortation, and Reflection. And without attempting any summarization of this, I'm going to step aside and not stand between you and Annapurna. On behalf of my co-curator, Asad Lalji, and our team, it really gives me great pleasure to welcome you, Annapurna. Could I invite you to speak?
Good evening. Thank you so much for inviting me to speak at the Kala Ghoda Festival. I would like to thank... Let me begin by thanking Sharada Dwivedi, because it was perhaps her books on Bombay, and so lusciously made, full of scholarship, but also written in a very inviting and legible way that made me aware of the kind of work that was happening in Bombay when I was a graduate student in New York City. I'd also like to thank Ranjit Hoskote and Korshed Debu and all of the Kala Ghoda team for putting this together. And also I'd like to really thank Kaiwan Mehta, because over the years he's been introducing me in ways which I had no idea that he was doing in Bombay. Me in the sense my work, which is somewhat different. So today I wanted to just talk to you about writing about art. And this is a topic that's very fraught for many people, because what is art writing? It's not literature in the standard sense, right? Though there are many literary figures, for example, Jeanette Winterson, who've written about art. There are many people who have been inspired by an artist such as Freud with Leonardo da Vinci. But in the recent past, except for someone like Ranjit or a few other people, the idea of writing about art for different kinds of audiences has become a really vexed issue in India. As many of you know, most newspapers don't have proper art criticism anymore. We don't have a very deep emphasis on writing as a form of creativity in art history programs. It's a kind of very clerical way of approaching writing. We don't understand, or conversely, it's so deeply ideological and politicized that there's no space for a young writer to kind of dig in and chew at a topic and develop skills with a tender but critical but nourishing mentor audience. So all of these things I'm very aware of, and I've gone through that experience myself. So I kind of thought, like, what do I present to this audience? Because I'm completely unfamiliar with what to do. So please take this as a journey of an art writer. And at the end, I'm happy to talk about some of the issues which I brought up in the little note that I put together for this lecture about economics and about editing. What's the role of an editor in India? Especially when it's about art and not about English or any of the other Indian languages, because editing a person who's editing art publications has a very different role in India. Having sat up there for 7 years, I used the bathroom, actually, I have had agonized. Am I editing too much? Am I doing too little? What am I doing? So I'm very happy to be here, and I'm happy to share. So let me just begin by introducing you to something that I think was critical in the formation of, in my formation, which is early childhood trips and a culture of making. So when I was growing up, my father worked in Bhopal at the BHEL factory, and that great Indian institution called Leave Travel Allowance allowed a young engineer who and his family to travel all over middle central India, western India, and a bit into eastern India. So when I was growing up, I was maybe three when I went to Khajuraho. The memory of it was so vivid. And now I characterize that memory. I don't know, like all memory, it's part fiction, part reality. But I remember very distinctly feeling that this is something that superhumans have made. It's a kind of extraordinary thing. Maybe a child today would experience it with a digital medium. But for me, the idea that you could make a building that reached to the sky and could hold, like, you know, all kinds of human activity and order it perfectly and then make this space that even 1,000 years later still was so powerful and strong. Or a place like Mount Abu, which was completely thrilling. Our visits to Shatrunjaya, Abu, Girnar were just thrilling, as just the sensuality of space and that experience of being in something which people another 1,000 years ago thought, this is a beautiful spot, we should do something here. Another really vivid experience I had, which has stayed with me and has had a deep impact on my work, is I'm Annapurna, of course, named after the goddess in Varanasi. And my parents took me on a pilgrimage there, I think when I was four. My mother had me do puja, and then she parked me on the ghat. And the pujari gave me a genda mala. He put it on my, chest. I was standing on the ghat, and this cow, not a bull, a cow, came and started chewing on my flower garland. And I remember not being the least bit afraid. And it's something, these are these little experiences around art, ritual, that have impacted me and made me think a little bit about not being afraid about addressing something that's completely different and new for me. Another important place that comes to my mind is Mandu, near Indore in Madhya Pradesh. Mandu is very impactful for many of my generation who are reading Baz Bahadur and Rani Rupmati, again in the news. And I put her in because of this. Because I encountered it first through Amar Chitra Katha and Chandamama, and then, of course, going to the site and coming to understand that when you go to a place both empty and full of lots of histories, and these are words I have now in my adulthood, but that feeling is very vivid and certainly led me to the doors of art history programs quite improbably, sometimes it feels like. And of course, I come from a class of Indian families, at least in the 1960s and 70s, where you made everything from the paintings on the doorways, the alpana or the mugu, as they call it in Telugu, or samosas, or how to make your own flower garlands, all of which are really interesting. Now I reflect, for example, the dots on the door alpana. That's the first time I really started understanding like abstraction in a very childish way. But when I look at a raza or I look at tantric art of the 60s and 70s and really reflect on these kinds of experience, the way that I connect to that is through my own experience of using dots, whites and reds, pure color, blood and coolness. And sometimes when I try to bring younger people in the classroom to this, I have to struggle to find metaphors in their own life right now, which connect to immediately to their experience of art and making. And of course, the triangle of the samosa. I mean, like, what a perfect shape. Like this idea that you make something and there's this triangle and it's a container and you put things in it and you do things with it. Very interesting when you look at an artist like Manisha Parikh, whose show has just opened at Zaveri Contemporary, and I have happened to work on her art for many years now. A process-driven artist. So now I'm going to like skip and jump and go to the importance of teachers, which I think is in my case, at least, unbelievable. So this is I began my art history. My parents wanted me to go into business. I was studying in Los Angeles in California at this gigantic state school with 35,000 university students. And of course, I had no interest the least bit in any marketing and business class. Though now, I seem to be very interested in business and finance, but that interest has come through art. So the first class I took was on history of Western art, and I got a big D because I was working three jobs and going to school full time. So at 2:30 in the afternoon after lunch, the room went dark and there were slides. I would fall asleep. Of course, I was going to get a D in art history. But that same teacher, when I was in my fourth year, said, you can take that class over again so you can get to a really good graduate school, and I took it over. And in that context, I really began to look at art in my undergraduates very carefully. So for example, what does it mean on this wonderful 6th century amphora of Achilles killing Panathea, the Amazon goddess? That their skin colors. What does skin color mean? What does it mean to put it on an object that was meant to hold wine? And why would the painter potter go to such extreme and very profound levels of beauty making to articulate these kinds of differences? Or I had a teacher who was my teacher for modern art. And of course, I wrote this miserable essay because I was confronting abstraction and Picasso for the first time. I chose as my topic Demoiselle d'Avignon, that very famous painting by Pablo Picasso. And I wrote this thing which was obviously not very well connected, because part of learning to write is to see your ideas like building blocks. And then you are the architect that's going to piece it together and make something out of that. Make a house that invites other people to come and live in it and share your vision of what that work of art or that idea or that poem is. I mean, that's the metaphor that I use. It works for me because I'm a designer. And I've also worked on lots of building projects. So she said to me, I forgot her last name, but her first name was Andrea, and she asked us to call us Andrea. She said, you seem to be really interested, but your paper isn't very good. Why don't you go back and write this over? And I'll work with you to edit this as many times as you want till you get a grade that you feel satisfied with. So she edited it maybe twice. By the end of that process, I was at an A-, and I thought that was enough work for her and for me. But it was like such a huge leap. And this is something that I've practiced in my teaching, in my editing, so many times that people get frustrated with me. Like, why am I expecting that they're capable of more? Why don't I just accept them where they are? And my feeling is that maybe good enough sometimes doesn't need to be good enough. Sometimes good enough is good enough. But sometimes good enough is a journey to the better. And of course, it was thrilling as I was working on this to discover Picasso's connection to African art. You see that photograph from the studio, so this real interest in archival research. And of course, it wasn't just Picasso, but people like André Derain, who were in Paris collecting African art. This was really impactful, for example, when I was working on an essay for Ramkinkar Bej, the sculptor, and understanding how he was using a British artist work that's very controversial of a female figure, a memorial monument. He was basing the British artist, Jacob Epstein, I think his last name is Epstein. He's very famous, I've forgotten his name. He was basing it, of course, on new books on Buddhist art that had yakshis in them. So this chain of inspiration, interpretation, I began to understand how, in a very kind of preliminary way, how ideas travel, how images travel, how inspiration worked in the modern world. And of course, there was this amazing experience I really had thrilling teachers. My Japanese art history professor, Joseph Newland, who's now at the Manil Collection in Houston, Texas, He told me that his teacher of Japanese art was in a Zen monastery in Japan, and he was really interested in seeing this amazing and very well-known Zen ink painting called Six Persimmons, considered a kind of treasure of art. And this painting was in that monastery, in that temple, the Daitokuji in Kyoto, and he really wanted to see it, and he kept asking his teacher, when are you going to show it to me? When are you going to show it to me? And Joseph, my teacher, told me that his teacher one day went to the bathroom and saw this wonderful painting there, and it was like a Zen koan for him, right? This surprise. And of course, I've put in this picture of how much it's revered, and it's on a scroll. So this idea that ideas and inspiration and teachers and misapprehension are all fruitful for teaching, for writing, for thinking about art was instilled in me by many experiences, such as this one. And of course, I just want you to know this wonderful little thought that the scholar Arthur Whaley said, Six Persimmons, this painting, is passion congealed into a stupendous calm. And it's a kind of way that writers have of writing very poetically into a work that allows you to experience art, but also experience words. And I'm not an expert on Arthur Whaley, but I've read him enough because he did a lot of work on Buddhist art and Buddhist texts. So it's really nice that even after nearly, I think, 100 years now, I'm still able to read Arthur Whaley's thoughts on this painting that was so meaningful to my Japanese art history teacher's teacher and the temple that he read at, he studied his Zen Buddhism at, and still feel like it has something to teach me. And then finally, I had this amazing professor for pre-Columbian art named David Brown. And his final exam was to look at some pre-Columbian terracottas or whatever you chose. And you didn't write anything. What you had to do was draw every single object. And what that made me do, which I don't think our students often get a chance, is to actually understand gesture, posture, texture, size, gravity, all these things as living elements that animate a work of art. So when you draw a work of art, art students do it in India all the time. Every single art school sends its students off to Gulbarga and to Badami and all these places, and they study at Ajanta. But art history students are almost systematically cleaved from the experience of knowing how to represent art, not in words. So it's a very interesting experience to have that my teacher gave me. And of course, you know, when you look at these objects, these thrilling objects from the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, they say so much about that society, so much of it which is comprehensible and so much of it which is incomprehensible. Why are so many images shown of figures sitting on the floor or sitting on something? We don't know where these objects would have been placed, with their hands in contemplation on their knees. What did that gesture mean? Or was it just simply a kind of gesture of everyday living? Certainly some of these images are not. As you can see in the middle image, there's a ritual object that's placed on his knees. So all of these things are very kind of provocative for somebody who's committed to looking at an early age, was asked to commit to looking at art as something that is not just in a museum, but is part of my own intellectual formation and thinking. Now, I'm just going to speak a little bit about maybe my first real experience of independent historical thinking, research, writing. It was for my pre-doctoral work. It was a fellowship I had at the Smithsonian Institution, the Arthur and Freer Sackler Galleries of Art. And I had been given a fellowship to study Braj Bhasha and Urdu for 5 years. So I decided I would work on painting from the Pahadi Hills. I've always been interested in literature. There was a good chance I could have been a literature student, but maybe I like not knowing words. Words come easy for me. But maybe I like not knowing words all the time. Maybe I wanted to always find a relationship with objects and making that existed independently of words. So I often, in the early years of working as a professional, I turned to working with literary texts. So the two texts I work with were Jayadeva, the 12th century poet's Gita Govinda, written in Sanskrit. Perhaps the most thrilling translation is Barbara Stoller Miller, but there's also a very interesting translation by the American literary historian who teaches at University of Hawaii, Lee Siegel. A very beautiful translation as well. And also the other text which I worked on for this exhibition as part of this pre-doctoral fellowship is Bihari, the court poet at Orcha in Bundelkhand, which is Khajuraho territory country. He was commissioned to write 700 verses, dohas, two-line couplets, and they're part Niti Shastra, instructions to the ruler of how to be. They're part Riti Kavya, very erotic poetry. They're part riddles, because they are in a language that's deeply infused with Persian, with Sanskrit, with Khadi Boli, the raw language of the people. And of course, with Jayadeva's own Gita Govinda and the importance that the Gita Govinda played for all these writers who worked with Radha and Krishna as the hero and the heroine of their poetry. So the first thrilling experience was we borrowed this work on the left, which is of Krishna on the bottom and this beautiful female Sakhi on the top. And this is from the Gita Govinda manuscript from Kangra. And it was cut to this size. And when I saw this image, it didn't make sense because it seemed to reduce the whole narrative to this very focused aspect of sex. And when you look at a similar painting from the same series, you see the context of the whole page and how it was excised. So let me just read to you a passage from a text that I wrote at the time, which gives you a flavor of how I was thinking about this. This is from an essay that went with this exhibition catalog. When looking at Rajput love paintings, a viewer may initially puzzle over the identity of the various women. A descriptive title such as Radha pining in separation from her lover, most often based on scholarly usage rather than a painting inscription, fails to account for the others present in the pictorial space. Equally perplexing is the almost complete absence of corresponding male figures. If a painting has a male, it is either Krishna or occasionally a king. For historians interested in pre-colonial conceptions of gender and class, particularly women's status, these love paintings are intriguing because they say so much more than art historical scholarship and popular coffee table books allow. Indeed, the radical dispersal of individual folios from painted manuscripts, especially those that deal with love, contributes to their problematic status. All of these paintings were dispersed after 1947, when many of these hill states liquidated their assets to get cash. Many Gita Govinda folios, especially the more explicit lovemaking scenes, have been reframed in this century, either by dealers who actually cut them or by publishers who reproduce these paintings with strategic amputations. Excess trees, excess in quotations. Open landscape, figures, and buildings are excised, incidentally mutilating the verse on the back, violating the poem's narrative, and trapping them in a telescoped erotic snapshot. These snapshots are regularly featured in the art porn genre of palm-sized editions, produced to attract impulse purchasing in bookshops throughout the world and as souvenirs of famous temple sites in India. To understand the ideas that Rajput art communicates about the gendered body, devotion, love, sex, and poetry, we need to reframe these paintings, seeing them as illustrations to a category of texts that were not in their own day devalued as pornography. This exhibition was curated at a time when these paintings were shown in Delhi, and I think it was the Bajrang Dal that attacked that exhibition of Kangra paintings of the Gita Govinda and of the Satsai as being disrespectful to the gods. It was so interesting to me. And of course, this exhibition was attacked and questioned in Washington, D.C. and in 1997, because at that time, the funding for the National Endowment of the Arts was being questioned by Congress and the presidency. And they said that this exhibition, which was called The Handmaid's Tale, after Margaret Atwood's novel, female friendship and Rajput painting, was perhaps promoting lesbianism on government money. So all of these experiences were so weird for a 27-year-old beginning scholar. What I was also very interested in was a kind of way that the writers of these texts, Jayadeva for the Gita Govinda and Bihari for the Satsai, were used by the painters of these texts. The paintings are not illustrations, they're actually interpretations of the texts. Each of these paintings often has several verses on the back. They were meant probably as marriage gifts, that you would have viewed them, you would have turned them over, you would have had somebody to read them. Not every king was literate. You would maybe look at them, you would gift them. They might have had some kind of auspicious value, apotropaic value for a newly married couple. So the painters often painted the writers into the pages, either at the end, as in the case of Jayadeva on the left, or at the beginning, as in the case of Bihari on the right. So the verse that's illustrated or interpreted on they serve both functions, illustrative and interpretive, that's shown on the painting on the left. It's the verse translates as, "Poet Jayadeva sings to describe Krishna's desolation. When your heart feels his strong desire, Hari will rise to favor you. Wild flower garlanded Krishna suffers in your desertion friend." And then, of course, the temporal implication of these two verses has been established in the painting. So Jayadeva's world, Krishna and Radha's world, and of course the world of the painter, and then the world of the court, and then our world are all brought together in conversation at the same time by these painting. So in the final part of the Gita Govinda, which is where this painting comes from, the verse that is there at the back, his musical skill, his meditation on Vishnu, the his is of course Jayadeva, his musical skill, his meditation on Vishnu, his vision of reality in the erotic mood, his graceful play in these poems, all show that the master poet Jayadeva's soul is in perfect tune with Krishna. Let blissful men of wisdom purify the world by singing his Gita Govinda. So there is no kind of disjunction between sacred and profane, erotic and aesthetic, between religious and the spiritual, between salvation and pleasure, Sringara. This has been said many, many times, but it's worth repeating again and again and again, because one thing this text teaches you is that the past is another country, and we have to respect that otherness of the past in order to impose a sort of a presentist consciousness on them. When we look at the other painting with Bihari shown, it's another world. It's the same painters, actually, the same family that painted both sets of texts. The painting on the back of Bihari's painting translates, well, in Braj it is, Meri bhav bhada haro radha nagar soi ja tan ki jai pari sham harit duti hoi. So in that, it translates something like, remove the pain of my existence, Radha, you skillful woman, you whose golden complexion turns Krishna green. When you mix golden and blue, what do you get, of course, is green. So the word green is both happy, harit is both happy as well as green. So all these lovely plays of words and meanings that the artists and the painters would have known. And they intend to kind of make divine grace, aesthetic pleasure, all available to us. But in very different ways. Of course, if you look at these paintings, you see that Jayadeva positions himself almost as an equal in conversation with Krishna and Radha, whereas the Radha and Krishna in Bihari Satsai are almost like a Rajput king and queen, and Bihari is a courtier, and standing very obsequiously in front of the two of them. Finally, this particular project gave me a thrilling opportunity to understand the world which I had come from as an Indian girl, the world that I had come in as an art history student who looked at craters which had a dark-skinned Achilles and a fair-skinned Amazonian queen. In this painting from the same series, it's called Village Beauty. That's not what the artist called it, but that's how it circulates. It's in the Kronos collection in New York, which has now been promised, I think, to the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And let me read to you the process, how I wrote about this painting. The folio from a late 18th century painted Satsai illustrates an uninscribed verse. The verse is not inscribed, but we know very clearly which verse from the Satsai it shows. A Sakhi's description of a peasant guarding her fields. The verse translates in the following way. A garland adorns her chest, flax flowers her brow. Standing up, the girl with upright breasts guards the field. So the poet doesn't tell us anything more than this. The artist appreciates Bihari's equation. The riches of the ripening grain fields match the bounty of the girl's body. Her stance is upright and guarded. Her breasts blindly gaze back. Because the beauty's head is turned, watching for birds that might steal her grain, the artist can allow the viewer to relish a secret look at her body. Why I say secret is that device of the oval, which is coming actually from Western cameos that were coming to India, that oval frame, is kind of like a pill onto this scene. Her lushness, youth, and strength contrast with the aged go-between who sits in the balcony with Krishna. Though Bihari never specifies the type of go-between, the artist, aware of Riti Kavya conventions, juxtaposes contrasting female bodies to create a piquant eroticism. But this painting is not just a comparison of the beauty and her go-between. Krishna with his golden brown crown and the fine jewels is also contrasted with the village girl's simple attire. Although Bihari dismisses peasant life in general, he makes fun of it throughout his dohas, he does incorporate the historical tradition of celebrating Krishna's life in rustic Braj. A medieval commentary on the Kama Sutra, for example, states that for a gentleman, relations with peasants are degrading. They are merely substitutes for love. Such forms of sexual release, like neutral sex, are only possible if one disguises oneself. Of village girls, the only attractive ones are the cowgirls of Raja or Braj country. The artist skillfully represents the tensions of cross-class, cross-regional love through an erotic fantasy. Interpreting the listening male hero as Krishna allows the cultural symbols associated with his worship to inhabit the same frame as the world of the aristocrat. A contemporaneous viewer could easily see the village beauty as a brudge girl, uninhibited by town mannerisms and available for delectation. The aristocrat as Krishna, or Krishna as the aristocrat, is physically separated from her. He's able only to imagine what we know already in the go-between speech portrait embodied before us. The improbable relationship between the town building and the field, as well as the choice of the go-between, suggests that values other than strict devotion are central to the response sought from the audience. One is humor. Bihari's language is keenly playful. The other is an erotics of power. He knows about her, but does she know of him? He may want her, and given his status of as a god, as an aristocrat, does she even have a chance to say no? One of the most interesting experiences that I had was when I was doing research for a project one could think of it maybe as a radical education project. I took this painting to a model school in Jangpura in Delhi, a girls' model school. And most of these girls come from business families, Agarwal's Banya families. Very, very smart. They had bought replicas of objects from the National Museum and made a museum in the basement of the school for themselves and used it as a way of thinking about art history, museology. Really, really interesting. So I was asking them, you know, your CBSE curriculum, this was the years when the CBSE curriculum had been really vetted very carefully by people who were part of the JNU School Center for Historical Studies, and very, very advanced in terms of pedagogy, which required students to look at historical material, such as this painting, through the lens of their own experiences to allow them to connect. So I said, if you saw this painting, would you be able to understand some of its meaning? So we debated that. And then I said, look, she's a dark-skinned girl. He is a blue-skinned god. There's an old lady. How would the skin color work here? Skin color is a huge issue in this community, especially the girls. Skin color. And they said, yes, we would be able to look at this at home. We'd be able to talk about it with our parents. These are about girls from 8th to 10th standard. About maybe a minute later, one girl who was in the 10th class said, actually, we wouldn't be able to talk about this to our parents. And that was a very kind of moving moment for me, that this painting had the capacity to even at least give them the space to acknowledge what could not be spoken of with their parents. Because the pressure on them to be educated, yet be fair-skinned, and then to get married was almost upon them. Because after 12th grade, that was going to be their destiny. Finally, I'm going to conclude my lecture, my talk, by looking at what I consider to be something that I've, as a maturing person, I turned 50 this year. I'm talking about work that happened in my college years, in my 20s, in my 30s, now work that's happening in my 40s, which is, I hope, going to nourish my work in my 50s. And one of the things that I've been very strongly committed to is expanding the definition of art and what deserves scholarly interest, what deserves a writer's talents, hard work, research, and addressing the diversity of sources and voices that we encounter when we look at diverse kinds of art. So what I want to conclude this lecture with is these dolls, which are made by potters in, historically they were made all over South India, in Tanjavur, in Madurai, in Mysore, and many other places. These are dolls, terracotta dolls, now they're made often in plaster of Paris, which are made for Dasara, for a festival called Golu, a set of dolls which are set up by women, primarily these days, upper caste women in their homes for the 9 days of Dasara. And nowadays in many parts of urban South India, whether it's Mysore or Chennai or wherever South Indian communities live, like San Jose, there's competitions about who has the best and most creative golu. So I was very interested in this because I grew up making these things. I collect these dolls. I'm fascinated by the miniaturization of our society these dolls represent. I'm fascinated by the kind of urban discourse about civic pride, about how to teach civicness, civility. Through these golu displays, you see this around Dasara time in every single newspaper, from the Hindu to the Bangalore Mirror to the Deccan Herald. And I'm also interested in how these are becoming heritage objects, rightly so in the Dwivedi lecture. So let me read to you a little bit about these dolls, what I've written in an essay that's been published in a book funded and edited by the Tasveer Ghar Project. For urban buyers, the lure lies in these objects. They're all about this big, they could be whole temples. Like one year I bought the entire Ratayatra at Arunachalam, which was about like 40 dolls. And they're priced anywhere from 50 rupees, 100 rupees, to about 5,000 rupees. If they're older, they have more value. If they're bigger, they cost more, all of these things. So for her urban buyers, the lure of these images, these dolls, lies in the scale of production implied by the handcrafted object. So not only are dolls from southern India collected, but of course from Krishnanagar and Benares and all these places. And also, like this year, your uncle went to Switzerland, bought you that wonderful image of Swiss Matterhorn, and you put it on your doll display. So the exotic, the new, the old, the mythical, the gods, and there's a hierarchy. You can read my essay. It's online if you want. So I'm not going to go into all of that. But what I want to bring your attention to is this whole question of diversity of art forms, voices, and sources. For urban buyers, the lure of these dolls lies in the scale of production implied by the handcrafted object, the figure of the artisan, and the display itself. Craftspeople dolls, as you see on your right, most perfectly captured the perfection of the miniature world, where enumeration of detail in reduced scale produces an altered temporality, even a sense of timelessness. So that tiny object has this capacity to make the world comprehensible. The world of the display and the household in which it exists seems uncontaminated by the gigantic scale and the consequent stresses of industrialized work or urban noise, at least during the duration of the festival. The tableau arrests time and provides a total view of the world in its stillness. So in that one image of a brick maker or a basket maker, you get his entire world in complete stillness. The tableau arrests time and provides a total view of the world in its stillness, even though most of the genre scenes involve activity. Working with miniatures and making a miniature world relieves the pressure of industrial time or elongates it. One of the main goals of any contemporary celebration or festivity, which often includes altered sleep schedules, shopping, feasting, drinking, gifting, vacationing, or coming to literary festivals, right? Vacationing as well. Like a potter's home, which is oriented around his occupation, the display becomes the central work of that household during those 9 days, particularly for the housewife who makes it. Whereas most middle-class families in southern India assiduously avoid the mess and waste that results from creative work, Dasara becomes a time where the process of display making loosens everyday standards of perfection and parsimoniousness. This outpouring of artistic labor, in turn, allows the entire household to identify with the display maker's project, which during any other time would cause great conflict in a community which still identifies many forms of artistic endeavor with manual labor. There is even a temporary identification between the housewife's creativity with the professional artist's labor as she invests considerable time, talent, resources, and energy into making the display of the golu. Blogger Usha Vaidyanathan, description of the work her extended family puts into their golu confirms this. She writes, this is taken from her blog post, Dasara is a special time at my cousin's place, as my cousin and her daughter are very skilled, and everything on display is made with their own hands. And some of them cannot be made in advance, like the doll she made with vegetables this year, and are created on the day of the display. It doesn't match, the display and the text don't match, but you get the idea. At a time when South Indian middle and upper class families are straddling the Indian and the global, and the traditional function to smooth over and bridge differences, reminding people here and there of common origins and utopian moments, even as they make relationships in other places. The possibility exists in these changed circumstances that the display itself might be wrested from the purpose of making or asserting Indian tradition and instead serves NRI, non-resident Indian domesticity. The latter cannot be conflated to the former. Since NRI homes create hybrid domesticities that allow for zones of Indianness, say in food, a puja room, or a handwoven rug, but also zones of Americanness, Canadianness, Australianness, etc., such as in the children's room, the formal dining room, especially in the US where NRIs form one of the wealthiest ethnic groups, the making of the domestic sphere is a complex negotiation between their class and caste origins in India and their class or aspirations in their adopted homeland. Women often parlay markers of tradition, not just to celebrate nostalgically a separate practice, but also to compete in a circle of peer NRI households. In a society where color and ethnicity define social upward mobility, NRI women also invoke heritage, art, and craft as status symbols, which allow them to enter a wider social sphere in their host country. If a Dasara display at home was a domestic ritual, in the host country, it is projected as a long-standing familial commitment to capital A art. The shift from domestic ritual to capital A art, or heritage, capital H, is a remaking of the past to create the present. It is an active attempt by NRIs to demonstrate to socially influential people and groups that they're not mere third world migrants or technocrats, but come from a class which has long been aware of more lofty things. And I think that's partly the reason why non-resident Indians have been really some of the premier buyers of Indian antiquities and contemporary Indian art. I come back to the essay. For those of you who don't know that word, that means housewives, the ideal housewife, who live between here in India and there in the foreign elsewhere, and often have not entered fully the transactional economy of the host country, whether it's Australia, Canada, or the US, the shift is often unsuccessful. When the protocols of Dasara display and comportment are extended beyond the familiar, women like Kamala, who was sitting in Saratoga in the Silicon Valley when she was writing this blog post, they write about their discomfort. Saratoga, this is Kamala's words on her blog post, Saratoga is one of those quaint little towns in Silicon Valley that is filled with Tamilians. I'm not sure how this came to pass, but there's a huge concentration of people from the Tamil community who celebrate all the festivals with great gusto. I discovered that there's a whole Golu circuit that the Tamilians in the Bay Area travel during these 9 days. And many travel 100, 150 miles over the weekend. The conversation did not vary much, and this Golu celebration was a tailor-made opportunity for them to catch up on which company was going IPO, which stocks were doing well, who has started what company, and who made how much money, etc. While it was nice to go around and see Golu celebrated in Silicon Valley, I somehow preferred the way it was celebrated in Madras, which had a touch of sincerity and innocence. This poignant statement articulates the fundamental paradox at the heart of contemporary Dasara displays. When class differences among display makers are few, as was the case until the pre-liberalization era, the Golu had the effect of uniting individual households into a community which differentiated itself from others, especially those that were a lower class and caste. The sincerity and innocence that Kamla longs for was a product of a world where state-sponsored capitalism controlled the way most families spent their money, like leave travel allowance, right? And public sector employment flattened differences among the families that made Dasara displays. People who came of age in that era remembered the event primarily as a time to install a few dolls, many of which traveled to them across generation, visiting each other's houses and eating homemade treats. Now the display is as much an opportunity for women and their families to vie for greater social status amongst their own as it is an event that confirms social relationships. Finally, I have a bit that I could read to you. I'll read it to you because it's about heritage. This is what I would call advocacy. I also write sometimes to advocate more publicly than the type of things I've done, read to you so far. This is from the Sunday Herald in 2010 for World Heritage Day. And I begin by saying heritage is one of those words that makes listeners sit upright and think pious and lofty thoughts about the greatness of tradition. Or it might engender irritation and sniggering as images of well-heeled socialites and naive conservationists pontificating in front of colorful crafts and older buildings flash by. More often, both reactions are possible at the same time, given the complex relationship we have with our bond to the past and desire for the new, and with the deeply knotty relationship prevalent ideas about heritage share with larger political questions facing India. Today, heritage is a concept, a perspective on the world, a politics, if you will, an academic discipline, and an industry. Given at the end of this essay that I wrote, given the ambivalent tone of this brief summary of the history and politics of heritage in India, it is best to conclude on a more uplifting note. And there is one, and it does not need to be manufactured in the interest of being positive. All over the world, and thankfully in India as well, oppressed, deprived groups and social movements are wresting heritage from its traditional elite votaries. Groups and organizations like the Dalit Neo-Buddhists, the Mithila Art Institute, the Union of Community Museums of Oaxaca, Mexico, the Rayum Institute of Art and Culture in Phnom Penh, Cambodia, and the post-apartheid community museums of South Africa are turning the balance and mobilizing their inherited community knowledge and history. They use heritage to serve the needs of the present and reappropriation, as in the case of the Buddhist sites in the Western Deccan, offer counter-readings of the past which contest academic or government archaeology, the tourism industry, or elite cultural organizations. There are complexities in all these projects, but there is little possibility of wholesale sanitization, because in such endeavors, heritage is an inherently political, constantly negotiable idea. I wrote this in the context of many people bemoaning that, oh my God, all these groups and communities are like turning Humpy into something that it wasn't intended to be. But of course, we all know that the living site is the one that lives longest. That's primarily, and it keeps changing based on who's the holder. Finally, in the last in the last few words, I want to say, what do I think about writing? I think that historical thinking is important. Ethical writing is important. I think it's really important for people to value facts and evidence. In writing about art, research is really important. It is important to do archival work, read extensively, and understand the history of all sources we use. This is especially the case in the internet era. Most importantly, the writer has to develop intimacy and a deep engagement with a work of art, a practice, a building, a community, etc. Interpretation is also important. I think interpretation, which is what I've tried to show you in when I talked about the paintings, is thrilling, and what it does is allow you to enter a work of art from a distant place in time and kind of gain an intimacy to the artist, the poet's intentions, their ideas, their subconscious desires, all those things. And those are worth getting access to. It's interpretation. And facts and evidence help you guide your interpretation. Argument is really important, taking a position. It's okay, as Geeta Kapoor once said to me, to be partisan, as long as you have an understanding of your own partisan and your own nature and your own position. And also respect for the other side or the other positions, your location. And that comes from reading extensively again, from proper acknowledgement and citation practices. So poorly done in our community of writers, especially because our universities don't teach that properly. Learning to see the other side, even when it's really, really hard. We have this tendency, even now, more and more these days, to argue from a purva paksha mode. You know, like this idea that the other side is something you have to defeat in order to stage your own argument. And finally, an honest and respectful acknowledgement of disagreement, lack of comprehension or disinterest in understanding a work also can be very productive and fruitful. And then last but not least, I think it's really important to know that as a person who works on historical material, there's a huge thing that you just don't know. There's a lot of not knowing. And that's why I keep coming back to this idea that the past is another country, and we're only kind of invited or barge in there and can only do a very, very respectful but very limited job with understanding it. Thank you very much for inviting me. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them. If my time is up, I'll get down.